Hi. Peter Eisenchild. I've been Postgres contributor for many, many years. Work for Second Quadrant doing Postgres development and support. And I'm here to talk about the new logical replication feature that we've been putting into Postgres 10. So for those of you who are not at all up to date with the Postgres versions, Postgres 10 is not out yet, right? So this is a preview. You can't hear me? Okay, is the microphone working?
Are you wearing the microphone?
No, we're using this one here.
If I move away, let's talk and we'll see if it's different.
Hello, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Is this on?
No.
Well, then let's. It is on. Okay. I'll just try to be more loud. Okay. So Postgres 10 is not out yet. We'll have more on that this afternoon at the panel of what Postgres 10 is doing and so on. So this is all a preview. But one of the reasons I want to do it, obviously, just to tell what we're doing, but also just to encourage people to, you know, download it and test it out before we release it, possibly. So what I'm going to do is first I'm going to do a demo, and then if we have time, which we'll hopefully do, I'll go then back to the slides and do some theory. So make this a little bit bigger. Look at my screen. So as I was saying, this is Postgres 10. That I updated yesterday, so this is all in flight. Is this big enough to see reasonably? I'm going to do some SQL and that kind of thing. Yeah, okay. So just to start, do initdb with a data directory. So this is all normal stuff. Start Postgres. So just because I'm putting, you know, I want to replicate from one instance to another instance, I'm going to put two instances on the same host now. So I'm going to give them two different port numbers. In reality, you can do this any way you want. And in this case, I have to do wall level logical. And I explain later why. This is a little bit at the bottom of the screen here. It'll scroll up, so you'll see that. All right, can you see that in Postgres? So Postgres is running now. One side thing to point out, in Postgres 10, we finally changed the log line prefix default to show something useful. So you can see that this is all default, right? So you see timestamp and pit there. That's also quite nice. And you see some new interesting information there of what addresses it's listening on. So these are just other improvements in Postgres 10 that are kind of nice. Try to have more useful defaults. So this is going to be our master or primary, how you want to call it. So that's running now. So I'm going to do another one. Call it data directory 2. And so I'm just going to start the second Postgres on the second data directory, we'll give it a different port number. And in this case, I didn't have to add any extra options for wall level or anything like that. So we have two instances running now. So I'm going to connect to the first one, create a database. Table. Okay. Insert some stuff. It's my favorite test data here, always very easy. Right. Up. Into. All right. Cool. So now we have some data, and now we want to replicate that. So now comes a new thing. We're going to create a something that's called a publication. So there's a new command for that, create publication, even a tab completion. Just give it a name. We always call them mypub because we haven't thought of any better names yet. And for table test one. All right, so this is a new command. So did something. So what a publication does is basically just group tables together that you want to replicate. And in other systems, you might call this maybe a replication set or a table set or anything like that. So this doesn't do anything interesting, really. It just kind of creates a grouping of some tables, all right? So there's a you can do select star from publication. That's a system catalog, so it's there, you know. There's also a backslash command to show these, and because all the good letters were already taken, it's backslash D big R P. Okay. So P was already taken, and the little r was already taken, so big R is for replication, right? And so hopefully you don't have to type that often. All right, so it has a name, it has the owner in this case, and then some attributes that we'll come back to. So again, this didn't really do anything, it just registered some stuff in the catalog. So the interesting thing will happen if we go to the other guy. So on the receiving end, again, we have to create a database to put stuff in. And now we have to, so one thing that this does not do yet is replicate any kind of schema, right? So the schema that you wanna, meaning the tables and all that stuff, is not replicated, so you have to create that yourself. And that's something that could be addressed in the future, but right now you have to do that yourself. So put that one in here. And in reality, you might use pgdump with a schema only to copy the entire schema around, right? So now we have a primary with some data. We've created a publication. We created the table that wants to receive that data. And now, in order to actually start this whole thing up, we're going to create the opposite of a publication, which is called a subscription. So this is a new command as well. So create subscription, some name, and then you tell it where you actually want to connect to. So this is a connection string now. So in this case, our endpoint here is the other host that's run locally on this port, and the database name is test. And then you could add other things like username and things like that. So, but this is just default. So we tell it where to connect to, and then we also have to tell it what it should pull, right? So that's the publication. So we just add the publication name here that we have, my pub. And that should be it. So now it told you a couple of things. It already said that it did stuff. So it created a replication slot on the publisher. If you don't know what that is, not that important right now. And it synchronized table state. So it claims it has pulled the initial data down, so we can just check here. All right, there you go, replicated. So just to verify that this actually works, we can insert new stuff in here. What's next? Three. Da, da, da. There you go. Delete stuff, need from test. And it's gone. All right, so that's replication. So DRS here, there you go. So that's basically the gist of it, right? There's some attributes and nuances and things that I'll explain, but these are actually all the pieces that are true. That's it. There's publications, subscriptions, you tie them together, that's it. So if you want to monitor that at some point, it's actually very similar to physical replication. You have some of the same things. So you can use pg stat replication. it's the same PG-STAT replication that you know, because it's the same mechanism. On the sending side, it's all the same mechanism, right? It's just instead of sending physical bytes over, it decodes it into logical information and sends it over. But as far as the receiver is concerned, as far as the sender is concerned, it's very similar. So you can use the exact same stuff. You have a, you know, the same sort of LSN tracking there of how far it's gone. And one other thing that's new in Postgres 10, actually, as of only a couple of days ago, is this kind of stuff here, down here, the lag tracking. So you can track the lag in a time value instead of just these abstract numbers there. So you can use all the same stuff. And replication slots, you can look at in the same way. It's the same thing again.
So was the slot created when you did the subscription?
Yeah, the subscription connected and created the slot, right?
So then is the data catch a separate slot?
Those are all very good and very detailed questions. We will maybe come back to those later, okay? Yeah, but yes, essentially. On the receiving end, there's something new, PG-STAT subscription. If you were doing physical replication, you might, in this case, look at PG-STAT wall receiver, but this is sort of new, so it shows you what the subscription is doing. Yeah, not super interesting unless you kind of throw a monitoring system on this that really tracks all these numbers. And you know, you can compare these numbers here with that and that, so if you want to really do detailed debugging, all the information is here, right? Any questions about the demo before I go back to sort of the theory? Yes, please.
Is it bidirectional, or
can you? No, only one way. Yeah. You can you can hook it up in two directions, but then it's just going to keep on rolling, and you know, you can do it, filter and do manual things that way, but in principle, it's just one way. Absolutely, and you can wire those together with partitioning, perhaps, and interesting things will happen, yes. Yes?
Is there a limitation on the data types that you can replicate?
A question on what data types you can replicate. The data types are communicated as strings, essentially. So if you have a data type called HStore here, and it sends data, it expects it to do something related on the receiving end, right? Yeah. Okay, so that's how it works. So let's look at some slides. So here's kind of a sketch of what these objects mean. So everything here is by database. So if you have an instance with multiple databases, you have to, every one of them is completely separate. So you can have, you know, you could even set this demo up having one database just replicate into another database on the same instance. That wouldn't be quite as sort of interesting example, but you could do that too, right? So it's just per database. Inside the database, you can have a publication or many publications, and they can contain some tables, all tables, or no tables, and they can write to a subscription can pull from one or many publications, and the tables are matched by name. So the publication knows what tables it has, but so if you drop a table that's part of a publication, it will complain, and you have to use Cascade and that kind of thing. But a subscription doesn't really know what tables it contains until things start actually coming over the wire. So the subscription kind of just takes the table name it gets, just like the database, that data type name, right? It just matches them by name. So if we had done this demo and the target table was not there yet, it would just give you an error until you put the table there. The question over there? Yeah.
Are you not allowed to alter tables once you've published them?
The question was, since we're not publishing or replicating DDL yet, are you allowed to change tables? Yes, you can change tables. And there's actually some things that are handled. So if you have the target table, it's a different column order that's handled because it's mapped by a name. If you have, you know, what was it? If you have more columns, then that also works on the receiving end and things like that. If you add a column on the publishing end, let's say, and then that data starts shipping and then the receiving end is going to complain, that, you know, you can't find that one column, but as soon as you add it, it will then keep going. So it's pretty robust. It's not going to break like dramatically as in sort of older trigger-based system, perhaps, if that's your experience. Yes, please.
So in general, if you have added a change, you would want to apply it to the replica before the primary?
If you have an additive change, you want to add it to the replica first? Yeah, that might be a good general guideline, yeah. So the syntax of the commands, just to kind of give you some of the variants that you could do. So you can have multiple tables in a publication. There's a special way you can create a publication that contains all tables, including tables you create in the future. So that's just a special case if you just want to replicate everything. Okay. If the transaction fails, yeah, transaction integrity is fully there, yeah. Well, that's how this works, right? Everything is, this goes over the write ahead log, and the write ahead log is decoded and put back together on the other end, sort of, roughly speaking, right? Correct. So on the sending end, the question is, the write ahead log is not going to be recycled until all this stuff is shipped out, essentially. So on the sending end, this is almost exactly the same as what you have now for physical replication, right? So if you have the replication slots that preserve the wall until it is acknowledged on the receiving end. It's almost exactly the same as you have now with physical replication, right? So publication for all tables, and then you can have some options that if you create a publication that you can choose if you want to publish insert, update, or lead, delete, or not. So you can use that for special use cases. Perhaps you don't want to publish deletes if you do some kind of archiving replication, so you just copy all the inserts and maybe the updates, but any deletes you just skip. So that might be for some specific use cases, right? Or you just want to maybe log all the updates, perhaps. I don't know if that really makes any sense, but you can do that. And then they just don't show up at the receiving end. It just is as if that didn't happen, right? So you can alter publications, you can add tables, remove tables from it on the fly. That's totally fine. Or just completely, so the first one adds some tables, the second one completely replaces a set of tables, or just remove tables. Yeah. And this is obviously very shocking that you can also remove publications and multiple of them. And again, a publication is just a logical grouping, so this just kind of removes some catalog entries, essentially. Question in the back, sorry, a little louder? Is a little louder again? Multiple subscriptions for the same publication, yes, they're independent. Yeah, because every subscription has a different replication slot, so they're completely tracked separately. Yeah, that works. So you can combine, you know, it's basically an end-to-end mapping of publications and subscriptions if you want. That totally works fine. Yeah. Yeah.
And I have a logical one set from the primary. And every connect subscription, we are using the host DB name and port number.
Yeah.
But the primary failover to the standby.
Yeah.
And the replication is completely broken.
Okay. So the question that kind of goes much deeper into what I was going to say later. If you have a physical application from a primary to a standby, and then you have a logical replication that is looking at the current primary using the host information, and then you fail over, how do you manage that? There's a couple of problems with that. One, you can change the connection information. That's basically the next slide, the alter command. You can change that. Of course, you can also use, you know, sort of DNS CNAMEs or virtual IP addresses to have that move around automatically. Then you need to make sure all your ARP cache and all that stuff happens. That's the same mechanism that you would use for any other HA solution. The other thing is that basically what you're describing doesn't actually work yet, because replication slots are not replicated, so at that point the thing is broken, and there's something in an eternal patch on the hacker's list that is called a failover slot that should fix that. I don't know where that is at right now. Do you know that's still somewhere out in the future, right? Yeah, okay. So basically that kind of thing doesn't work yet, but that's definitely something we want to fix at some point. So
we'd like it if that worked.
Yeah, we'd like it if that worked, but there's some problems with that. So you can, there's a bunch of options with subscriptions, which have to do with, so as soon as you start a subscription, as we saw in the demo, it connects out and it does reserve stuff on the receiving end. There's some options you can fiddle with to avoid that. And one of the reasons for that is perhaps if you take a backup with pgdump and then you restore that somewhere else, you don't necessarily want to start replicating right away, depending on what you want to do. Maybe you're setting up just a copy for development or something like that. So you can fiddle with these options that it creates a subscription, but the subscription is disabled or it doesn't connect or it doesn't do the initial copying of the data. So you can have a sort of a detached copy of that. So that really depends on the use case of what you're trying to do. So that's why subscription have a bunch of options when you create them. So and you can alter subscription, enable, disable, so that basically just stops the replication, restarts it, or change the publications that work with it. And the last one, the refresh, is if you add tables to a publication, then you have to run this command to refresh that, so it goes out and fetches the new table set, so it knows to initialize its internal state. And then you can drop it. And again, here's the thing, dropping the subscription by default connects out to remove the replication slot. But if you, let's say the primary host is somehow gone, that won't work, then it will fail. So you can give it the option of just not trying that and not dropping the slot. If you just do that and leave the slot there, then bad things will happen because the stuff is going to accumulate, right? So this needs to be managed carefully, as everything, because you allocate some resources and say, here, I want to replicate this stuff, just hold on to that for me until I get it. But then if you never come back, it piles up, right? So that's just something that you have to implement locally, see how you want to monitor that. That is the same thing that applies to physical replication right now. So subscription. So here's some configuration settings that are somewhat of interest to setting this. And so the first one I showed in the demo, you have to set wall level to logical. That just means information is put into the walls to enable the logical decoding. So, and then the next two settings, max wall senders, max replication slots. If you're using physical replication now, you might have seen those because you have to set those, but in Postgres 10, we changed the defaults for those to be non-zero, so you can use it out of the box now. I think they're set to 10 by default. So that's why they're in parentheses. If you want to do a lot, then you might have to raise those, but the out-of-the-box defaults are now a little bit friendlier, so you don't have to worry about too many of those. And you know, if you want to replicate to a non-local host, you have to set listen addresses so you can just connect. That's nothing new. And to configure access control, you just use normal HPA stuff. And there's also a plug to a new feature in Postgres 10, SCRAM authentication. That's also new. So, but otherwise, the HPA stuff is pretty much the same as before. So basically, you have to make sure you can connect to the host, and you have to set wall level to logical, then you're set. The other two are more if you need to have more resources than are configured by default. On the receiving end, as I showed in the demo, you don't have to set anything by default, but here are some settings that could be of interest. Again, max replication slots you have to set, and this is totally weird because you don't actually use any replication slots on the receiving end, but that max replication slot setting also sets the number of replication origin tracking slots. Therefore, some historical reason tracked in the same way, so that's something we should probably fix because that's super confusing. But you basically have to set that to also a value that's high enough. And the other ones are basically how many worker processes for various scenarios can you allocate. And those worker processes are just the general background workers that also apply to a parallel query, for example, or anything like that. So I think the default for that is maybe 8 or something. So, you know, if you have a lot of parallel query going on and a lot of this, then you have to raise that, otherwise they are just not, there's not going to be enough processes available. And then you can also fine-tune that, like how many workers do you want to have specifically for logical application, and there's a parallel setting to that for the parallel query, so you can kind of split up the buckets of how many processes you want to allocate to everything. And then the last one is how many workers do you want to specifically have for the initial syncing, so the initial copying of the original data. And you can parallelize that because it can parallelize it by table. So if you have a lot of tables, it will by default use two per subscription. But depending on what you want to do, if you want to get done quicker or more gently, you can, or slower, yeah, or more gently was going to be my term, you know, then you can tune that too. But they're at least to get started, they're set to something reasonable. So this is still something we're working on of exactly how to do the sort of privileges and permissions around all of this. So the way it works now is there is the privilege to be able to create a publication that exists. Publication is not something very dangerous because it, as I mentioned several times, it just allocates some catalog objects. In order to add a table to a publication, you need to be the owner of the table, so that's pretty okay. In order to be able to connect to replicate, you have to have the replication attribute on your user. That's the same thing as we have so far. In order to be able to, and I showed the HBA stuff, the same stuff. In order to create a subscription right now, you have to be a super user. And that's just because we haven't thought of any better way to do it. But that's maybe something we'll fix before the final release. Because the only reason why a subscription is special is it creates a connection to the outside, and maybe you want to restrict that somehow. It doesn't by itself, if it has any superpowers in its own database, but somehow you want to have a way to tell, not to allow everyone just to make external connections, right? So somehow we have to add a user attribute or something that controls that. But that's basically the general idea of what we're putting together here. I showed those are the same, mostly the same views. And in Postgres 10, most of this stuff will also show up in pgstat activity. That's a new thing. Somewhat new thing that all the background workers will also show up in pgstat activity. Is that committed yet, Robert?
Yes.
That all this stuff? Yeah, so that's in there already. I want to actually see that. Okay, so we have the AutoVacuum launcher here, Relogical Application Launcher. There it is. See? That's cool. So you can also use pgstat activity, and you see all these logical application background workers running around, and you can see if they're waiting on anything, like maybe IO wait or anything like that. It also shows up there. Cool. So there's two kinds of background workers running on the subscription side. One is the launcher that always starts right away, more or less, and sort of monitors if you have any subscriptions. And if you have any, then for each subscription, you get a worker, which is this one here.
How does it know?
How does it know what?
Whether you have any subscriptions.
From the PG subscription system catalog.
Is that a shortcut?
Yes. Don't tell anyone. All right. So that's the nice thing, essentially, more or less for your replication monitoring, you can use almost exactly the same facilities that you have now for physical replication. For the same reason, synchronous replication is possible and just works. There's nothing special that had to be done to make that work. So you just on the sending end, you can say synchronous commit, you know, remote write, remote apply, all these things, and you can have all these facilities that determine like who's the synchronous standby and who are the other ones, and all these quorum things that they're adding now, that all works just fine. Right? So cascading is possible, and that kind of ties in what the question was earlier, not in the sense that there's sort of a global awareness of cascading, but you can hook these one-to-one connections together and have another one hanging off that in any way you want, right? Or going around in a circle, and as long as you filter things, that should work. So you can do that. But it's not in a way that, you know, maybe Sloney, if you have used that, maybe that there's global awareness of all the nodes. If you have node 1, 2, and 3 in a cascading setup, that one knows about 3, even though they're not talking directly. It's not like that here. It's just a one-to-one thing. And this could be something that could be improved in the future. Right. So why are we even doing this? Perhaps we should have started with that. So two big use cases, essentially. One is any kind of partial replication. If you just want to replicate one database or one table or some tables, part of a table, certain actions on a table, that's what this is all about. And there, you know, the actual use cases for that are any kind of data aggregation into any kind of data warehouse kind of analytics kind of things, or for archiving, anything like that, right? It's just a toolkit to do interesting things. And another big use case is the upgrades from major version to major version that we want to facilitate with that. So that's not going to really come into play until we release Postgres 11, so that you could use this to go from 10 to 11. But we hope, aspire in the future that if you have multiple hosts available or facilities to do that, you just point one to the other, it replicates over, you switch over, and you're good to go. So that's another alternative to, you know, PG upgrade is great for in-place upgrades, but if you don't want to do that, you don't have disk space or anything like that, you just replicate to another host. You can do all the synchronous replication type of things, so you can do a completely lossless instant failover. Right. Question there.
Is it backwards compatible, like upgrade from 9.6 using PG Logical?
Question is, if it's, is it backward compatible to PG Logical? No. Yes, yeah, so if PG Logical, what he's asking about is a similar product, similar to this, but as an extension. And which, for the most part, actually completely inspired this feature, right? But if you want to replicate from something that is pre-Postgres 10, you would, at least, you know, my recommendation would use PG Logical. And that goes all the way back to 9.4. And then you can keep using PG Logical with 10 too, and I presume we're going to keep updating it for quite a while still. Yeah.
But they should be essentially feature parity.
Well, PG Logical, that's kind of my tomorrow's talk, really, if you want to go into that. But there is some pros and cons to both of them. Eventually, they should kind of merge, right? So those are the big use cases, or anything else you could think of where somehow physical replication is not working for you. Yeah. Yes, please. How do you achieve failover with this? Yeah. Question was, you want to do failover from A to B, that gets promoted to master, and then you want to fail back later. So it doesn't really work that way, in the sense that there is no real master and standby in this case, because any node can do anything, right? And there's also no restrictions on writing to, if you have a subscription writing to a table, you can still write into that table, do anything you want. Right? It's not like Sloney or Londisa that put triggers on it and prevent writes. Maybe you want to do that yourself, but it doesn't do that. So if you fail over and then you want to fail back, you have to set up the subscriptions and publications yourself in a different way. So this is not going to, and this kind of goes into my couple of slides down, is this is not going to replace your physical application just for your basic standbyness. Because physical application is just nice and simple, okay, for that use case of, I just have a complete copy here, and it's always there. Whereas here, you can set up a lot of different things in a lot of different ways, and there's no real designation of who is the leader and not. So you could implement that, but you have to do a lot of it yourself. Questions, yes?
A two-part question. Can logical replication be applied between schemas on the local host?
Can can logical replication be applied between schemas and localhost? Yeah, I don't see why not. Yeah.
The second part would be, would there any thoughts to allow logical replication to use transforming expressions to the data that's being replicated?
Any thoughts to you do allow logical replication to transform expressions as you...
Allow transforming expressions on the replicated data.
Any thoughts about it? Well, I think that would be a sort of a plausible feature down the road. There's no reason why that couldn't be done. You just have... So this is all built on the logical decoding feature that was added in Postgres 9.4. So this is just one consumer of that. And the way that API works is you just have a bunch of hooks and you can consume data and then you can do anything you want with that data. So this implementation is just a very simple implementation of that. It just takes the data that it publishes and writes it back into the table. But you could conceivably hook in anything you want there to rewrite that data any way you want. So that could be some feature down the road that we could add. Yeah, questions in the back, yeah? Is the plugin for logical decoding separate? It is compiled as a plugin that sits on disk. You could, I don't know if you can do much with it on its own. Yes? Yes.
Will just that row get rejected, or?
If the writing to a subscribe table fails because of a uniqueness constraint,
because you're also something
and you do in some writing also, yes, yeah, good question. So if writing to a table on the subscribing end fails for any reason, such as those kind of user space reasons, then it will basically keep trying that, and you will see errors in any of these monitoring tables or in the logs to see why it failed. And they have two options at that point. One is that you somehow fix that situation, like change the unique constraint violations or put the table in place or add those columns or anything that was missing of that sort. Or the alternative is you can kind of skip that record that it was inserting. And there's an explanation in the documentation of how to do that. There's a very specific internal function you call sort of to sort of pop a record off the queue in that sense to discard it. So you can do those kind of things, yeah.
Will that stop the whole replication or it will just stop for that table and rest of the tables?
It will stop the replication for that subscription because that stuff all comes out of the replication slot. That is PGLogical, what you're talking about. PGLogical has more facilities to do conflict resolution and filtering, which might come to this at some point. All right. A lot of questions now. Okay, let's make sure we get all this in here. We can take a couple more questions now. There's not much left here. Yes, that there. Do triggers work on a subscription end? Yes. Yes, no problem. Yes. No, you're right. You can only, for the initial sync, you can only replicate what's on the master now. Again, that works through the replication slot. As soon as the replication slot is created, at that point, everything's preserved until you consume it.
Okay.
Yeah. Maybe over there?
Can I replicate catalog tables?
You cannot replicate catalog tables. Nice try. last question maybe for now. Do we maintain the order of the tables in subscription? Do we, the data, roughly speaking, the data comes to the subscriber in the same order as it was published. Well, it's not exactly correct because there's some reordering to make it look correct, but the way it is ordered, the insertion should work under all those constraints. So that works, yes. It's basically it. There's a lot of internal work that is to make it happen. Okay, maybe last question for now. Does the subscriber apply single-threaded? There is, as I showed, there's for each subscription, there is one worker. So it is single-threaded per subscription. Yeah. All right, let's move on. So this is stuff that's currently not implemented. I mentioned the schema stuff. One kind of big thing is it doesn't replicate anything but sequences right now. And that's just because the logical decoding API doesn't support that, and no other workarounds have been implemented yet. That's just, you know, someone who just had to sit down and code that, and that's definitely something you want to do soon. So the, if you have, so it, this is not a problem if you just replicate, if you have like a serial column, and it inserts, you know, numbers in a table. The table will replicate just fine, including all those numbers. So if you just want to make a copy for archiving or analysis, then that works just fine. You have the numbers there. But if you want to fail over to a copy, all the sequences are still going to be on one, or, you know, the start value. So then you have to maybe use pgdump or something like that to move all that over. You know, so it's not great yet, but it's, you know, very similar. If you maybe know, familiar with Londista and these kind of things, they also have to play tricks with sequences like that. Also, we don't replicate truncate for a similar reason, that it's not exposed in that logical decoding API. Again, if you've used Sloany in the olden days, that was also a problem in the beginning. So that if you just truncate locally, it's just not going to replicate. And we only currently support replicating from a base table to a base table. What does that mean? You can't replicate, say, from a table into a view. Or you can't replicate from a view into a table. You can't replicate from a table into the root of a partition table. You can only replicate from the same partition to the same partition. And that's also just could be fixed. You just have to go in and implement all those different cases. Right. So here's some other sort of ugly things, perhaps, or things to be concerned about a little bit. So again, I said it's not going to replace your physical application just for one-to-one copy, because there's just a lot more moving parts that you have to worry about. So you could probably fiddle all this together, but you know, it's not going to be as easy. There's a thing called replica identity, which you have to think about. What that basically means, just to summarize it, is you have to have a primary key on a table up to some other conditions, right? But generally, you need something like that. So otherwise, you cannot replicate any updates or deletes, because it's not going to know what to key those on. You can insert, because all that does is just append rows. But if you want to replicate updates, you have to have either a primary key or something that you declare instead of a primary key. So another thing that is just general to the logical decoding is that if you have a long-running transaction, it's not going to start replicating that until the transaction commits, which is unlike physical application, because physical application just moves the bits and bytes around, and they are then interpreted on the receiving end whether they were committed or not. But here in this case, because we have to wait for the transaction to finish before we know in which order we have to send it around, long-running transactions will basically create appearance of lag. And I already mentioned initially the sort of, we're not quite clear yet how to package that best, of how pgdump should interact with subscriptions by default. Should it just dump them so when you restore them, the replication starts up right away? Should it dump them in a disabled state? There's also issues with like the connection string, for example, that we put in the command might contain a password. You know, maybe that's not a good thing to do, but it's possible, and in some cases necessary. So that is a sort of secret information, so not everyone can read that out as part of pgdump. So we'll probably have to be a bunch of different sort of marginal options that you can pick all these different behaviors, right? So finishing up, this is for Postgres 10 feature freeze is presumably tomorrow. So anything that's listed here is not going to get done for Postgres 10. But certainly, a lot of those are reasonable to attack, at least initially, for Postgres 11. Multi-master stuff is probably, in the future at some point, something we want to do. And the better integration with physical application is what the point I already made about failover slots. Like if right now, if you have a subscription if you have a logical replication hook up and you do a physical replication failover, the whole thing is broken, you have to start again. And proposals for that are out there. We kind of know the issues, but you know, there's just a lot of work and coding and thinking to do. Some credits. I'm just here so as the spokesperson. I didn't actually do most of the work. Main author for Postgres 10 is Petr Jelinek, who is currently at home in Europe. A lot of the reviewing and also work on logical decoding and a lot of work in early releases from Andres Freund. A lot of who is here if you want to find him. A lot of reviewing and testing in this release came from Eric Rikers, who we don't know who he is, but he's on a mailing list and he did a lot of good work. and he sends email through a Tor relay, so I don't know what that is about. And Craig Ringer has also contributed a lot to just the general area of logical replication in Postgres. So those are kind of some people. If you know see their names somewhere, you can also thank them. And many others have contributed as well. So at this point, you know, it's committed. A lot of the initial work came from people affiliated with Second Quadrant, but right now it's sort of, you know, a community property kind of thing. And many other people have already pitched in, so it seems to have some good momentum. Advertisement for tomorrow at 9 a.m., I believe it's actually in this room. This basically the, I think of it as a sort of the follow-up to this, if you want. That's just, because Second Quadrant is a conference sponsor, and we get like one talk slot that we can do whatever we want, so we're just going to keep talking about logical application. And I'll kind of contrast these different solutions that people mentioned here, PG Logical and BDR, which is bidirectional replication, and this new thing here and how they fit together and how they came about and what the different trade-offs. So if you have questions about that, then I invite you to back here tomorrow at 9. Otherwise, we have maybe two more minutes for questions specifically about this here. Okay, here. Yeah.
Can I break the standby and convert it to the logical? Because there is a script available in 9.6 where the PG breaks subscriber. Is there anything similar to that one in 10? Where I can convert the streaming replication to logical replication?
No, I don't think so. Let's do just these two more questions then.
Is it possible to do copy on a published table?
You can do copy on a published table. You can copy into a published table and then it will replicate, yes.
With a copy command.
Yeah, that's fine. Copy works fine. And last question, maybe?
I think you said that you could do synchronous commit.
Yes.
So in the case where someone did violate a constraint that you were talking about
earlier. Yeah, it will hang on the master, yeah.
So
yeah,
it would have gone to the back.
Yeah. So you can also find me outside on the Second Quadrant booth throughout the day, or just catch me tomorrow here. So thank you very much.